not even being dramatic, I think that this is one of her best songs ever. This is absolutely a holy grail song for me. This song really kind of itches my brain in the right way, and it's just straight up not it for me, and that's really all I have to say. Hello everyone, welcome back to another video. If you're new here, my name is Taylor and welcome to my tower. For today's video, we are going to finally be tier ranking the Tortured Poets department as well as the Anthology, which this album has been out for 3 months now and I am just now getting around to tier ranking it, but I really wanted to absorb and, you know, just really like cherish each song before I actually, you know, felt comfortable to properly rank all of these songs. I just wanted to quickly talk about my headband. So if you can tell, it says Swiftie all over it and I think it's so cute. So this is from Gingerbread Couture. We'll have it linked down below. Taylor has recently created a bunch of Swiftie hair accessories, so be sure to go ahead and check that out. And without further ado, let's get on into the video. So I've already gone ahead and named my categories, so I will just go over quickly why I chose the names that I chose. So first we have LOML, which is definitely going to stand for Love of My Life. These are the Holy Grail songs. I think that these are like some of the top songs in Taylor's entire discography. And for the second category, we have But Daddy, I Love Her. These are the songs that I still love, but they're just not quite top tier. Then we have One Hell of a which is just like our mid category. They're the songs that I still love. I'm not gonna skip them, but they're just not quite, you know, the top two tiers. And for our second to bottom category, we have Monday Stuck in an Endless February, which is kind of a harsh name, I'm not gonna lie, but these are just the songs I'm not quite clicking to, but they're also not skips either. And then for our bottom category, we have My Boredom's Bone Deep. So these are gonna be all of the skips on the album for me, unfortunately. So at first, we obviously have our album opener, which is And the one thing that I really love about this song is that it's a continuation from Midnight's, because in Hits Different, Taylor refers to being sent away because, you know, she's just so madly in love. There's nothing that can really get her away from this person. And she just very bluntly opens up Fortnight with,
I was supposed to be sent away, but they forgot to come and get me.
So I love that we have that like perfect transition from Midnight's into this album. I just think it works out beautifully. Something I will say about this song though is that I do wish that Post did have his own verse. I think that they sound so beautiful together. I think that this is definitely the best collab that she has on this album, and honestly one of her best collabs like ever. I just think that they sound so good together, and I just really wish we had a little bit more Post, but I do think that his voice is supporting her in the way that we needed it to. And I just really love that this song is a single, because I really love the music video that we got. I feel like it's a perfect music video for this song. I think that every single choice that she made makes so much sense. You know, she's wearing this white dress that could have potentially been a wedding dress that never got used. And, you know, she went from this previous relationship to a fortnight of a relationship, just something that was shorter term. And, you know, now they are just neighbors, because if you think about it, Maddie and her are still in the music industry. So they're going to continue to see each other in passing, and they'll just always be neighbors because of the industry that they're in. And, you know, she loves him. It's ruining her life because she knows she's not supposed to be with him. Like, there's just so much about this music video, about this song, that just makes so much sense. It's just so good. And I also just have to say that I think that the outro of this song is such a banger. I think that is the best part of this song. I really love the lyrics, because it's just like my dream, honestly, to move to Florida and own my dream car. So I feel like I can really connect to the end, and that's where it really picks up, and they just sound so good. And I've talked a lot about this song, so let's just go ahead and rank this. I'm torn between One Hell of a and But Daddy, I Love Her, because I do think that it's higher up on the list, but I just don't know how high up I would necessarily put this. I think I'm gonna put this under One Hell of a Drug. And then up next we have our title track, which is
The Tortured Poets Department.
Honestly, this song does fall short for me. I don't necessarily love the production, and I think what draws me away from this song the most is how descriptive it is of Maddie, and I just don't like him for obvious reasons. I think it's just mostly in that second verse when she calls him a tattooed golden retriever that just really like I will say that I do like the line where she says,
you smoked them 8-7 bars of chocolate,
because in the 1975 song Chocolate, there are 7 bars of lyrics and 1 bar of rest in the chorus. So, you know, 7 bars of chocolate, I think, was such a creative decision. There are certain things that I do like about this song, but there's also just like how descriptive it is. Don't love it, but it's also not always a skip. It is sometimes, but I don't know if I'd want to put it all the way at the bottom. I think for now, I'm going to put this under Monday Stuck in an Endless February, but it has the potential to get down to My Boredom's Bone Deep. Then we have I still don't know how I feel about this song. I still feel like I need a little bit more time with it, but overall I think it's the production that really steers me away from loving this song. I think the lyrics are great. I think that when she says
the sickest army doll purchased at the mall,
the sickest army doll that I can think of is a G.I. Joe. So this is also such a painful song because, you know, when she says, that is like one of the most heartbreaking lyrics she's ever written, and she puts it in a pop song, which is so typical of Taylor to do. I just don't necessarily love the production of this. So for now, I think it's gonna go under Monday's Stuck in an Endless February, but it's gonna go before the Tortured Poets Department. And then we have Down Bad, which is such a good song. I love this song so much. I just love the imagery that we get, you know, in the cloud of sparkling dust. I can just envision her standing, you know, kind of how she does on the stage before we even saw that performance. I could just see her looking up at this beam coming from this UFO. Like, the song's just so descriptive. I see such a clear mental picture when I listen to it. I love the production. It sounds perfect for an alien abduction. And we also have that fun little nod to 1989 from New Romantics when she says, please leave me stranded, it's so romantic. And then in this song she says, how dare you think it's romantic leaving me safe and stranded. Which is such an iconic line from the song because she's saying, like, how dare you do the right thing for me by leaving me here when I just want to be with you. So at the end of the day, Maddie did do her a favor by leaving her because he wasn't good for her. He wasn't right for her. So I just think that was a beautiful way for her to write that into the song. And it's just, the production is so good. It really does something to my brain when I listen to this song. I don't know if I want to put this under LOML or if I want to put this under But Daddy, I Love Her, because I really do love her. But is it one of her top tier songs ever? Yeah, it might be. I'm going to put it under LOML. Then we have our typical Taylor track 5 with our most like a heartbreaking song of the album, and that is So Long London. There's just so many lyrics in this song and so many powerful lyrics, and I'm not gonna get into every single one, but some of the ones that stick out to me are, I kept calm and carried the weight of the rift. Because, you know, the meme or the saying from England where people say, keep calm, carry on. Her brain is just literally such on another level that I can't even comprehend it, and I never will, but that's okay. And I feel like you can really hear how almost pissed off she is, because she literally says, and I'm pissed off you let me give you all that youth for free. She spent a lot of time with Joe, and you can really feel how hard she tried to make that relationship work, even though it just couldn't, because she literally went down with her white knuckle dying grip. So, like I said, there's so many good lyrics from this song, and I think that I want to put this under LOML too, but honestly, I don't listen to this song quite enough, but this is definitely going to go under But Daddy, I Love Her. Then next, we have one of my absolute favorites from this entire album, and that is But Daddy, I Love Her. This song to me just feels so much like the Fearless and Speak Now era. And honestly, I feel like if Taylor were to give us a country album now with Jack and Aaron producing it, I feel like I would trust them because of what we've gotten from this song specifically. But now that I've really kind of like understood that Speak Up Now movement and realized how ridiculous it was, of course she's gonna write a song about it. And I think that she wrote the perfect song, honestly. And how, you know, this relationship is one that she just really felt like she was just running free, just living her best life. She didn't care what anybody else was thinking. Sanctimoniously performing soliloquies I'll never see. And it's just such a beautiful, perfect song. And this is gonna go under LOML. This is gonna go before Down Bad because I just love this song so much. Then up next we have Fresh Out the Slammer, which this is a song I'm definitely not necessarily connecting to. I think that there's a lot of lyrics in this song that I'm just not quite understanding. It's not quite a skip for me, but I think that this is gonna be under Monday's Stuck in an Endless February. And I'm gonna put this behind My Boy Only Breaks His Favorite Toys and in front of the Tortured Poets Department. Then we have Florida, featuring Florence and the Machine. I really did have such high hopes for this song. This was one of the ones I was anticipating the most because, as you guys already know, I'm a huge fan of Florida. So I was really hoping that we would have almost like the kind of slut vibes, you know, where it's very like ethereal. And, you know, we obviously still get descriptions of Florida as a state and, you know, Destin and how people go there to escape and stuff. But for me, I don't love the production of this song. And this is just a personal opinion, so please don't come for me, but I am just not a fan of Florence's voice. I don't love her verse. I don't think that it's making a lot of sense, at least to me. I just don't like when she says, all of the bodies that have ever been on my body and in my mind, they sink into the swamp. Is that a bad thing to say in a song? It doesn't work for me, but I will say I like the outro of this song. I need to forget, so take me to Florida. So yeah, that has kind of gotten me to like this song just a little bit more, but it's still not quite hitting for me. So this is gonna go under Monday Stuck in an Endless February. And I think I'm gonna put this in between My Boy Only Breaks His Favorite Toys and Fresh Out the Slammer. Then we have Guilty as Sin. not even being dramatic, I think that this is one of her best songs ever. I can't think of a single negative thing to say about the song, from the production, from the lyrics, and just how beautifully she can write, you know, what she's doing in this song. She's feeling guilty for having these feelings when she's in a relationship, so she's like, am I allowed to feel this way when I am almost guilty of something? But am I guilty because I haven't physically cheated? Someone told me there's no such thing as bad thoughts. Only your actions talk. It's just such a perfect song. This is definitely going to the very, very top. It's going before But Daddy, I Love Him, and it's definitely the love of my life. Then we have Who's Afraid of Little I definitely love this song, and I love that she just kind of sat down at the piano one day and just wrote the song, because what else would she be doing with her time? But I really think that the Eras Tour performance of this song has elevated it for me, and I really do think that this song is an important one in her discography as well, because she has faced a lot of bullying, a lot of unnecessary drama, and just so much throughout her career and throughout her life that has really shaped her into the person that she is. And she's the kind of person that doesn't take any shit, and she's letting you know that in this song. If you do her dirty, she is going to make sure that she gets her revenge, and I love that about her. It's one of my favorite things about her. And so just the fact that we have a song just kind of dedicated to her power essentially is just so good. I think I'm gonna put this under One Hell of a Drug, and it's gonna go before Fortnight. Then we have I Can Fix Him. No, really I can. I just love the way that the song comes full circle, because we start off with her just kind of saying, everyone keep your opinions to yourself, I'm gonna fix him, I'm the perfect girl for him, like don't you worry, he's gonna become a good man. And at the end she's like, no, actually I can't fix him. Whoa, maybe I can't. And I actually do really enjoy the kind of Midwestern vibes of this song, which is not something that I would definitely say is like a vibe that I am drawn to. So the fact that I like this song is honestly kind of a little bit of a surprise for me. But I think that this paints Maddie in the light that I almost see him in, as just kind of like this bad boy who's, you know, speeding down this highway and kind of has this like deep, dark vibe to him. The smoke cloud billows out his mouth like a freight train through a small town. I know I just kind of like spoke kind of highly of this song, but I'm feeling like I want to put it under Monday Stuck in an Endless February. It's just a matter of like, where do I want to put it in there? Her voice sounds so good in this song to me, so it's hard because like I want to place it a little bit higher. But I think for right now, I'm going to put this behind My Boy Only Breaks His Favorite Toys. Then we have LOML, which if you guys follow me on Instagram, you know how I feel about this song. This is absolutely a holy grail song for me. I am so attached to this song. As soon as I hear like that opening piano, I just instantly like calm down. I just want to sing along. And I think that the bridge, especially when she says, dancing phantoms on the terrace, are they secondhand embarrassed that I can't get out of bed? Cause something counterfeits dead. I just envision her being so crippled with depression that she cannot get out of bed, but she's like almost envisioning the ghost of their relationship, dancing on the terrace, all these good times that they had together. Is that version of herself embarrassed because this version of her is upset about that relationship that didn't even mean anything to him essentially? So I just think it's some of the best lyrics that she's ever written. And she does something that we see her do kind of in a lot of her songs, where she will start with a lyric and then in the next verse she will flip it. So for example, when she says, I felt a glow like and then in the next verse, we hear her say, but I felt a hole like this never before and ever since. Just so powerful. Like, there's just so much beautiful lyricism in this song. And then in the outro, too, when she says, I'm combing through the braids of lies. I'll never leave, never mind. Like, it's just so painful to listen to, but I am such a ballad girly to my core. They are some of my favorite kinds of songs to listen to. So yeah, this song, it's definitely up there. I think I'm gonna put it before Guilty as Sin, because there's just a connection that I have to this song that I can't explain. But honestly, all these songs up in the LOML section are just kind of equally tied, but LOML is the LOML. Up next, we have our newest single, which is I Can Do It With a Broken Heart. This song is so iconic for so many reasons. I love that we have all the background noise going on. We have like what she hears in her earpiece. I think that that was so creative for her to do that, because she literally still had to perform the Eras Tour with a broken heart, not once, but twice. So she really just has proven that she is capable of performing the most successful tour of all time when she's been heartbroken twice. She's just literally an incredible person. I cannot sing enough praises about this woman. I just really love that she incorporated Travis into this song too, because he quite literally has picked her up from the depression slump and, you know, the heartbreak that she was experiencing. And I just love that for her. So I think I'm gonna put this under But Daddy I Love Her, because it's up there, but it's not like quite up there. Sometimes I will still skip this if I'm not in the mood for it. So I think I'm gonna put this behind So Long London. Then we have
The Smallest Man Who Ever Lived,
which is a painful song. Once again, I really love how this is performed on the Eras Tour, how she has all the drummers come out and they're just slowly one by one going down. It's just such an incredible performance, such an incredible song. It's just like so sad, and she's like, did you just do this just to waste my time, just to kind of lead me on and then leave me? It's just overall really sad that she even had to go through this relationship, especially with the smallest man who ever lived. So this is gonna go under But Daddy I Love Her, and it's gonna go behind I Can Do It with a Broken Heart. Then we have our Travis. He made it to the big game, and that is
The Alchemy.
Honestly, I don't know if it's the production or just like the pacing of this song in general, but it's just not quite there for me. Like, I still love it, I'll still listen to it, and I'm not gonna skip it, but there's just something about it. I think it's just a little too slow. So I don't know, I feel like there's still just like a little bit of a disconnect for me when it comes to this song. And so I think I'm going to put this under One Hell of a Dream, and it's gonna go behind Fortnight. And then for our last song on the original Tortured Poets album, we have which honestly, I did skip this song for quite a bit of time, and I still do here and there. I don't know what it is. I think it's just honestly relatively boring to me. I really do have to be in a certain mood to listen to this song. I don't know what it is, but I'm just not necessarily drawn to it. So I'm gonna put this under Monday Stuck in an Endless February. Because I listen to this more than these other four, I will put them before them, and I will put this after My Boy Only Breaks His Favorite Toys. Now moving on over into the anthology, we have our first song, which is
The Black Dog.
This is a song that from the very first listen, it had me in tears. I just felt like the ending especially was so beautifully written. It's such a descriptive song about a very specific place that she used to frequent with Joe, and you know, just talking about him sharing these memories with whoever his new lover is gonna be at these places. I love this song so much, and I also just really really love the bridge of this song when she said,
now I wanna sell my house and set fire to all my clothes and hire a priest to come and exercise my.
Because she just cannot get rid of him and either his smell or his memories or just his physical ghost of still being with her where she lives. And it's just so painful. And so for that reason, I love it. I know I'm like a little crazy, but I really do love a slow ballad, heartbreak song. Like, I just really, really eat this up every time. So this is gonna go all the way up to Love of My Life, but where do I wanna put this? I think I'm gonna put this in between But Daddy I Love Him and Down Bad for now. Up next we have
I'm Gonna Get You Back,
which is such a banger. I love the production of this song, and I just really love her vocals. I love the pacing, the production. It's just so good. Always puts me in a good mood when I hear this song. And so I'm gonna put this under But Daddy I Love Her. For now, this is gonna go before So Long London, just because right now I'm like really on a kick with this song. Okay, so up next, I don't know why this is a little bit out of order, because The Albatross is actually next, but we'll do
Chloe or Sam or Sophia or Marcus,
just because that is next on this tier ranking. And I, once again, just like Clara Bow, would say that I skip this song maybe half the time. I don't necessarily hate it, so I'm not gonna put it in my boredom's bone deep, but I definitely still need to learn more about this song and just really try to fathom it, and then I think maybe I'll feel differently about it. But for now, I'm going to put this under Monday Stuck in an Endless February, and I think I'm going to put this in between Clara Bow and I Can Fix Him, No Really I Can. Then up next we have
The Albatross,
which I feel like I'm the only person in the universe that's really loving this song, and I'm not sure why, but I'm not seeing anybody talk about it. But this song really gives me such a clear mental picture. Like, I can just see her being locked up in this tower and the mad village people down below screaming at Travis, like, she is so bad for you. Do not get caught up in this devil. She's gonna just ruin your life.
Locked me up in towers, but I'd visit in your dreams, and they tried to warn you.
And Travis is kind of like breaking through them, and he's like, I don't care. That's my lady.
That's my lady.
And he turns out to see that she's an angel.
The devil that you know looks now more like an angel.
There's there's just something about this that is just so visual for me. But I just love that once again, Taylor is talking about how the media villainizes her and how in this song, if you get to know her, you'll see that she's not like that at all. I almost want to put it under LOML because I really do love it. But I think I'm going to put it under But Daddy, I Love Her. And I think I'm going to put it in between So Long London and I Can Do It With a Broken Heart. Then up next we have How Did It End, which is such a good song once again because her and Joe's breakup was so bland. There was nothing really dramatic about it. It was just not the tea that everyone wanted to hear, whether it was Taylor telling people or like the media interpreting it. I love that she's just kind of talking about the gossip of a post-breakup situation, which again is such a very specific situation that she wrote so beautifully, which she's just so talented at doing. And she's almost just like, I can't even tell you how it ended because I'm not even sure.
I can't pretend like I understand. How did it end?
And that just really kind of puts into perspective how long she was really probably over this relationship. So I think I'm gonna put this under One Hell of a Drug, and I'm going to put this in between Fortnight and The Alchemy. Then up next we have
Some High School.
And this song really is exactly the title. It is so high school. It's gonna have you, you know, kicking your feet and giggling. And I think it really perfectly captures her and Travis's relationship. And I just love that she is so happy that she can feel free to just be herself. They can almost just like be kids together. There's just not a care in the world. They're just truly happy together. And I just love that for her so much. So I'm gonna put this under But Daddy, I Love Her. This is gonna go in between I'm Gonna Get You Back and So Long London. Then up next we have
I Hate It Here.
And this song really kind of itches my brain in the right way. I think what I love about it is because I'm just slowly starting to get into reading, and if you are a reader and you know this song, then you know how they're kind of intertwined. She's kind of escaping to this fantasy that she's created for herself, which I think is her music, or you know, just kind of literally getting away from the media, from the city that she lives in. But I take it that she is escaping to this fantasy world through her music or through reading, because we know that she loves to read. And you know how she says,
in my fantasies I rise above it, I actually love it.
Because she just loves this world that she's created for herself. And I just really love this song. So I'm going to put it under But Daddy, I Love Her. I think I'm going to put this in between I'm Gonna Get You Back and So High School, just because I listened to this one a little bit more than So High School. But I really do love all these songs the same. Up next we have
Thank You, aIMee.
Which is one of her most petty songs ever. But it's also such a very important song in my opinion, because I think that the like Kim drama has really kind of been like hushed down and just kind of water under the bridge, or so people thought. And honestly, the situation is so much worse than I thought it was, because I really just thought it was the whole like snake situation with the Kanye phone call. But it honestly just like it gets worse, and Kim is just such a mean person. But one of the lyrics that I really love about this song is when she says,
when I count the scars, there's a moment of truth that there wouldn't be this if there hadn't been you.
She wouldn't have built this kind of discography that she has with all these painful songs if it weren't for how dirty people have treated her, and you know how she rises above that situation every single time. It's just so beautifully written once again, and I really love this song. I'm going to put this under One Hell of a Drug. I think I'm going to put this in between Fortnight and How Did It End, because I do listen to this song quite a bit. It's also almost been overplayed a little bit for me recently because it's just coming on shuffle a lot for me. So I'm almost a little bit burnt out, but I still really love the song. So it's going to fall right in the center. Up next we have
I Look in People's Windows.
This song is so incredibly special to me, mostly because Death by a Thousand Cuts is my favorite song off of the Lover album. And this song tying directly into that, and just like starting off with that she had died the tiny death, you know, by a thousand cuts.
I had died the tiniest death.
And you know, with this song, she is still looking through the windows of this boarded up love that she's had for this person, and just kind of almost hoping that she'll see them on the street or in someone's window, just kind of like hoping for that one last glimpse of them so maybe she'll feel that closure. But they're still almost haunting her in a way. And I love the lyric,
chance fixed by rose gold and gloss,
because as you guys know, rose gold is my favorite kind of jewelry and just like aesthetic. And so the fact that she wrote that into a song, because like I feel like I can genuinely understand what she's saying when she wrote that lyric. But it's not just that, it's just this whole song in general. I wish we had a 10-minute version of this because it is so good. But I'm still grateful that we have this regardless, and this is definitely gonna go under LOML. I want to say that this is my favorite song because I do think like at my core this is going to be a song that's gonna stick with me for the rest of my life. I'm always gonna love it. Because it's not a full song, I don't feel comfortable putting it first, but I'm gonna put this in between Guilty as Sin and But Daddy I Love Him. But like I said, all these songs that are in the top are in the top for a reason, and they're all really kind of tied as one. But yeah, I love this song so much. And then next we have
The Prophecy,
which is such a heartbreaking song in my opinion, because all Taylor has ever really looked for in life, besides, you know, achieving her musical dreams and career and stuff like that, is really just to find true love. And I hate that she has gotten so much hate over the years. She knows when it's time to go. And so for her to just kind of essentially be slut-shamed for that her entire career is just really sad, and it just goes to show what it's like to be a woman in the media, and a very successful woman at that. And this song is really just such a plea to the universe to please just let her have this everlasting love. That's really all she wants when it comes to, you know, her personal relationships. And I just feel so bad that she felt this way at one point in time, but I'm also so happy that she now has Travis, which will hopefully work out for her forever. So I'm gonna put this under But Daddy I Love Her, and I think this is gonna go all the way at the end of But Daddy I Love Her, because I honestly haven't listened to this too much recently, but yeah, I feel comfortable putting it there for now. And then we have
Cassandra,
which is a song that definitely didn't hit right away at first for me, but now I love this song. I really love the melody mostly out of this song. I think it's so beautiful, and honestly the poetry in this song is incredible as well. And I think what she's referring to when she says that she was patching up the crack along the wall when she got that call is the call about the whole Kim and Kanye situation.
Patching up the crack along the wall, I pass it and lose track of what I'm saying, 'cause that's where I was when I got the call.
She was just minding her business, got drugged down into the situation, and you know, people were screaming burn the bitch when it came to the Taylor Swift is over party. And then when the truth comes out, everyone that said that is quiet.
When it's burn the bitch, they're shrieking. When the truth comes out, it's quiet.
She's always gonna rise above every situation that she's dealt. This song is no exception to her power moves, and I just love this song so much. And I also love the line where she refers to her cell being filled with snakes, because that's a perfect representation of that whole situation with the Reputation era.
So they filled my cell with snakes.
I think I'm gonna put this under But Daddy I Love Her, and it's gonna go in between I'm Gonna Get You Back and I Hate It Here, mostly because this melody is so good and the poetry in this song is just so good. Then we have
Peter,
which is a special song to me, obviously because I'm a Disney adult and this has to do with Peter Pan references, but also my dad's name is Peter, so even though the song doesn't paint Peter in the best light, it's still special to me. A fun fact about this song that I learned on TikTok is that in the chorus when she says,
"You said you were gonna grow up, then you were gonna come find me,"
she says that three times, and in the original Peter Pan story it starts out with, I'm not quite sure the lore of this honestly because I've never read this book, but it starts out with I think Wendy and then her daughter and then her daughter. So it goes through like three generations of women that think that they're going to live this happy life at Neverland, and then they never do because Peter never comes back for them.
And she repeats the chorus three times. "You're gonna grow up, then you were gonna come find me. Wendy, you were gonna grow up, then you were gonna come find me. Jane, you were gonna grow up, then you were gonna come find me. Margaret," all three women. She literally repeats the chorus three times to represent each of the generations of the darling women that were broken promises by Peter.
It's just very interesting to me that she's written a song, you know, about the Peter Pan lore, but also tying into her own relationship. And I honestly haven't looked too much into the meaning behind this song, obviously besides the Peter Pan references, but I'm pretty sure this is about Joe and how, you know, she was kind of hoping for him to almost mature with her in this relationship, but he just kind of never did. And, you know, referring to,
"And you said you'd come and get me, but you were 25.
And I'm pretty sure that is the age that either she or he was when their relationship started, if not both of them. I can't quite remember because honestly, like I said, I don't follow her life that closely. I just thoroughly enjoy listening to her music, and I don't feel like I need to necessarily understand every single lyric, but I do love this song, so I'm going to put this under One Hell of a Dream, and this is gonna go after Alchemy. Then up next we have
The Bolter,
which I think I like the concept of this song more than I like the actual song itself. This song is all about her leaving when she knows that it's time to go, and you know that ship is going to sink if she doesn't get out of there fast enough. So I understand like the concept of this, and I really like the second verse when she's talking about, you know, being in Central Park and, you know, being in the lake and stuff.
Central Park lake and tiny rowboats, that's when she sees the littlest leaks down in the floorboards, and she just knows she must bolt.
I feel like I get a very perfect kind of mental picture of that, but there's just still something about this song that I don't necessarily love. I don't know if it's the production or kind of like the rhythm of the way that she's singing. It's just not necessarily hitting for me. I'm not gonna put this all the way at the bottom because I don't think it deserves to be there, but this is definitely gonna go under Monday Stuck in an Endless February. This is gonna go in between Clara Bow and Chloe or Sam or Sophia or Marcus. Then we have, unfortunately, my least favorite song on the album, which is Robin. And I do understand this song, and I know that it was written for Aaron's son named Robin, or at least that's what these Swifties are speculating this song is about. But this is just such a snooze fest for me, and I feel so bad to say that, but I just literally skip this every single time. For the most part, I just genuinely do not connect to this song. It's so boring. I lose my attention span, and it's just straight up not it for me. And that's really all I have to say. So I'm going to put this under My Boredom's Bone Deep. And then last but not least, we have
The Manuscript,
which is another very sad song. I really love the subtlety of the piano in this song as well. We just get to really focus on the story that she's telling us and her vocals. And if I'm not mistaken, this song is rumored to be about the All Too Well short film and just kind of the manuscript for that, and really just kind of her whole relationship with Jake Gyllenhaal, which that's definitely how I interpret it. So I'm not sure if that's 100% correct, but that's the way that I listen to the song. And you know, when she says,
the age of him, she wished she was 30 and made coffee every morning in a French press.
That just reminds me of their age gap and how he used to sip coffee like he was on a late night show with her dad. That's just definitely the imagery that I get with this song. I just think this song is so beautiful. Once again, I think it's a perfect ending to this entire anthology, this entire album, this entire era. And I really love how she ends this song with,
now and then I reread the manuscript, but the story isn't mine anymore.
She said that when she released this album, that her releasing albums is a way for her to get the stories off of her chest. And once they're out into the public, they are no longer her stories. This is gonna go under But Daddy, I Love Her, and it's gonna go all the way at the end of that row. Okay, so here's my final ranking. This is how I feel about the Tortured Poets department. As you can tell, it is a very well-rounded album for me. There is something in every category. We have quite a bit under But Daddy, I Love Her. So I feel like for the most part, this is a very successful album in my opinion. And honestly, only having one song at the very bottom is not too bad when it comes to having 31 songs on this album. So I'm just so proud of Taylor for creating such a masterpiece and just taking her lyricism up even higher than I could have even imagined. She's just so talented, such an inspiration, such a role model for so many young women. I will always be a supporter of her, and yeah, I'm just so happy that we have this album forever. I would love to know your opinions on either my ranking or, you know, what you would place certain songs in your ranking if you were to do this. Go ahead and let me know your thoughts in the comments down below. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a thumbs up because it will help other people to find my channel. Also, be sure to subscribe for new videos every Friday, and I will see you real soon. Bye.